Hello, I'm Reverend Mike Critton with the Bowman Charge of the United Methodist Church, and I'm glad that you joined me for this week's sermon. This is the second Sunday in the period referred to as Lent, Lent leading up to the crucifixion of Jesus, his burial, his resurrection on Easter Sunday. So I'm glad that you joined me, and I hope you've had a good week. Temperatures here in South Carolina make it seem almost like it's summer right now. It's been in the 70s, so bright sunshiny day today. So we thank God for the wonderful weather. The scripture let us open, did it again. This is my second take on it. Anyway, let us open with a word of prayer. Almighty God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, open our eyes, ears, hearts, and very lives to your presence, so that today we may worship and serve you in faithfulness and be a blessing and healing reminder of your love to all whose lives we touch. We ask these things and pray this prayer in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Scriptural reading that I chose for this week comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 15 and 16. Again, it's Romans chapter 8, verses 15 and 16. Hear now the inspired word of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage, again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Again, that comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 15 and 16. And so, I hope you will open your hearts, your ears, and your mind to the teaching of this sermon. Lord, may the words of my mouth be pleasing to you this morning and be of inspiration to those who have gathered here for the reading and hearing of your most holy word. For it is in the mighty name of Jesus that I pray. Amen. The title of this sermon is The Spirit of Bondage and of Adoption. And again, it comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 15 and 16. John Wesley taught that there were three kinds of people in this world: the natural man, the awakened sinner, and the believer. He referred to their spiritual conditions as natural, legal, and evangelical states. Wesley also taught that everyone has free will. He didn't believe in predestination of the individual. Therefore, our spiritual status is not something that is fixed and unchangeable. God desires that all people are to be saved, and that Christ died for everyone. However, not all people respond to God's grace, the grace that allows us to accept his invitation to salvation. Some people totally reject the invitation. Others will eagerly start their spiritual journey, but they fall by the wayside when things don't go the way that they had hoped or planned. True believers respond to God's grace and are able to acknowledge their sins and repent of those sins. They trust in Christ and bear the fruit of everlasting life. God offers them the freedom of sin and breaks the bondage of sin. Unfortunately, the vast majority of those who live in what is referred to as the Christian world haven't even begun to trust in God on any level. They're still far from God's kingdom. Oh, there may be a few that love God, and a few that even fear God. However, the majority of those living in the Christian world neither fear God nor have a love for Him in their hearts. Wesley's definition of the natural man is someone who may or may not believe that there is a God. He says that these folks are asleep spiritually. These individuals may have heard God's call of sleeper awake, but have failed to respond. They don't have any concept of holiness. They're unaware of the wrath of God. To them, the devil is simply a cartoon character. These folks live in a life that, for the most part, is uneventful. They don't fear the wrath of God because they don't know that much about God. The only time that they pray is when they're in serious trouble. And if God doesn't answer their prayer the way that they want, their attitude is that, well, there must not be a God. These natural folks may also have the mindset that God does exist and that He'll show mercy on everyone in the world. Therefore, they believe that they can live their lives any way that they choose because Jehovah will be merciful towards them and forgive them. These folks don't fear Judgment Day, mainly because they don't think about such a thing, or maybe they don't even believe in such a thing. No, they believe that everyone will go to heaven no matter what they do during their lifetime. As long as their life is going along smoothly, these unbelievers don't see a need to change anything. They're content with the way their life is, so why change anything? They're totally unaware that they're living in a spirit of bondage to sin. Then there's the awakened sinner. These folks have been stirred by God's call, sleeper, awake. Suddenly, or in some cases, gradually, they begin to realize their true state of sinfulness. They begin to understand that God is just and terrifying. They begin to understand that they will be judged according to their work. Awakened sinners realize that God is holy and that the natural state of humankind is to be sinful and unholy, ungodly. Awakened sinners realize that they are destined to spend eternity in hell. They begin to not only fear God, but they become keenly aware of what is meant by the wrath of God. These folks begin to understand that the Word of God is sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit and joint from marrow. They understand just how sinful their lives have been. They begin to struggle to break the chains of bondage to their sins. However, they realize just how strong of a hold Satan has upon them. The harder they try to quit sinning, the more the desire is to sin. Yet, they keep trying. Eventually, awakened sinners desire to break away from the bondage of sin by making changes to their lives. Activities that once were prominent in their lives no longer seem to matter. Even their friendships and associates begin to change. Yet they realize that they cannot accomplish their desire. They begin to cry out, "Wretched one that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death?" They begin to search for the answer. This, my friends, is why it's so important for Christians to be willing to witness about our faith. These unawakened sinners don't walk around with a sign on their chest announcing the state of their soul. The awakened sinner is searching for the answer to who will rescue him or her from the wrath of God and the eternal lake of fire that's in hell. We need to share the gospel message with the world. As Christians, we not only need to talk the talk, but we need to walk the walk. A person moves from being an awakened sinner to a believer when he or she acknowledges his or her sin, feels remorse about that sin, earnestly repents of the sin, and asks Jesus to come and take control of his or her life. They begin to understand clearly that God, through the workings of his Son Jesus, has reconciled the individual to himself, meaning God. These folks now have the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit reminds them of the teachings of Christ. They now allow Christ, through the workings of the Holy Spirit, to guide them in their daily lives. The Holy Spirit now works with their spirit to assure them that they are a child of the living God. They have been adopted into God's family. Believers no longer fear the wrath of God. They no longer live in a state of anxiety. They have put their trust and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. They therefore now have an inner peace that nobody can take away from them. To summarize today's sermon, we looked at the three states of humankind according to John Wesley's teaching: the natural man, the awakened sinner, and the believer. We see that the natural man or woman is asleep spiritually. They may or may not believe that there is a God. They believe that everyone will go to heaven when they die, if such a place even exists. The awakened sinner understands that there is a God and that God will judge him or her come judgment day. They understand what is meant by the wrath of God. They understand that they're sinners, that they're living in a life that is in bondage to sin. They no longer want to continue living this kind of life, and they make attempts to change, to quit sinning. They also begin to realize just how strong the chains of sin really are. So they cry out asking for help, asking how to break the bondage of sin. Then they begin to learn about Jesus. They realize that Jesus paid for their sins on the cross. They realize that Jesus can and will break the chains of bondage to sin. They understand that by asking Jesus to come and take control of their lives, that they will receive not only the gift of the Holy Spirit, but they will also experience an inner peace that no one can take away from them. I hope you now understand why it's so important for Christians to witness about their faith. The world is full of seekers, awakened sinners, looking for the answer to the question of how to break the chains of bondage to sin. They need to hear about what Jesus Christ has done for you in your life. You need to help them understand that they can have that inner peace that nobody can ever take away from them. They need to understand that they too are an adopted child of the living God. Ask God to have His Holy Spirit work with your spirit so that you will have the ability and the encouragement to go ahead and share your faith with these folks. Ask God to help you to witness for the kingdom of God. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we live in a world full of seekers. Everybody is looking for happiness. What they need to be looking for is true peace. Anybody can have happiness for a short period of time. Oh, it may last for a week, a month, even a couple of years. But eventually they don't have a feeling of fulfillment. There is still a hole that they are trying to fill. They're trying to fill it with more material possessions or alcohol or drugs or whatever their addiction may be. The world is full of people who are seeking for something. So Lord, work with our spirit. Enable us to be your ambassador to the world. Help us to have the courage to share our witness about our faith. Help us to share what Jesus has done for us in our lives. Again, Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that you have already bestowed upon each and every one of us. And as your holy word tells us, if we are willing to simply open our mouth and start speaking about our faith, you will put the right words in our mouth. And yes, Lord, there are going to be those who will laugh at us or ridicule us or maybe even try to persecute us. But at least the seeds have been planted. Because as the Apostle Paul tells us, he planted the seeds, Apollos watered those seeds. But God, you're the one who made the fruit come to bear. And so by planting the seeds, we never know when the fruit will sprout. That is in your hand. But at least we will have done our part by planting this seed. We ask these things and pray this prayer in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Well, I hope you enjoyed this sermon. I hope you've had a good week, and I hope you are looking forward to better days ahead. Yes, they're rolling out the vaccine for the coronavirus. I hope that everyone will consider getting the shot or shots. So, you know, I keep praying that the Lord will take care of it and eventually end this pandemic that we're going through. So, you know, all we can do is hope and pray. It's in God's hands. Remember, He is in total control. We only see a small portion of it. He sees the whole picture. So, again, I hope you have a blessed week. And if you're not attending church in person, I hope and pray that you will go ahead and send your tithes, your offerings to the church treasury or the church financial secretary or whoever's taking in the money for the church. Don't forget about sending in your Sunday school offering. And we're going to close with a word of prayer. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, thank you for joining me this week, and I hope you have a blessed week, and I hope you turn in next week. Take care. God bless.